Good morning. We'd like to cordially invite Jim Wright to the platform. Good Christmas. Awesome. Good to see everybody this morning. Hope everyone is holly and jolly. We're going to have that conversation this morning. The Merry Christ Mass. It is good to see you this morning. Let's all stand together. We're going to do something different, which I don't know is that different since every week we say it's something different. But we're going to do some of the Christmas hymns, the Christmas songs today. So it's going to be a little bit different for us. Scott, if you would please, sir.
If you have your songbook, you can open your hymn book to song number 137. Song number 137 we're going to start with this morning, Joy to the World.
Yeah.
enjoy singing Christmas carols, you need to sign up on the back table to go Christmas caroling Saturday at 3:45. Yeah, we're all going to go sing at Brother Tony's house. No, that's not true. They are going to go to the nursing home and so on, but you can sign up on the back table to do that and go Christmas caroling Saturday at 3:45. You can be seated. If you're visiting with us this morning, or even if you're not visiting with us but you brought children with you, there is a children's Christmas party taking place even now as we speak. So I'm not sure where they are right now. Where are they now? In the gym? So if you have children up through the sixth grade, through the fifth and sixth grade class, and they would like to go to the children's Christmas party, you can take them to the gymnasium, see an usher if you don't know where that is, and they'll show you where that is. And the children's Sunday school department is having a Christmas party, so you're welcome to attend that and go to that Christmas party. But children's choir will also be singing tonight, bringing two songs, Christmas songs, in the evening service at 6 o'clock. So if you are part of the kids' choir, if you could be here at 5:30 tonight, and they'll get rehearsed and warmed up and ready to go, and they would appreciate that so much. We appreciate you being here this morning, and if you are visiting with us for the first time, I want to invite you to fill out this contact card that you will find attached to your bulletin, and we would have a record of your visit. Feel free to use whatever name you would like to use on the contact card. So that's a private joke among our Sunday school class. So but if you fill out that contact card, if there's any way that we can help you, you can indicate that on the card and just put that in the offering plate at the end of the service, and we would appreciate that so much. If you are able to stand for our Bible reading this morning, I want to invite you to stand in honor of the reading of God's Word. Our Bible reading can be found in your Bible. Here it is. That's what happens when the internet is slow. I'm using the YouVersion live event. You can use the YouVersion app and download that app and use the live event to follow along with Brother Tony's outline. And so this morning, God at Work, this is part 3. And our Bible reading is found in Luke chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. The Bible says, "It seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write unto thee in order, most excellent Theophilus, that thou mightest know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed." Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Word of God. We thank you for the man of God that preaches your Word in truth and in love. And we pray that the Holy Spirit might go from person to person in this room this morning and speak to our hearts, both individually and collectively, that we would be drawn closer to you, and that our hearts and minds would be stayed upon you, that we would hear the truth that you have for us, whatever it may be, that we can grow individually, grow corporately, be the witness and testimony for you that we ought to be. Pray that you would be with the other programs going on now, the children's program and the nursery and all that takes place, that it would honor and glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. I'm going to ask this time if Brother Don and Miss Julie, they're going to come and share a song with us before our message.
Child is dead. son Mary's lap is sleeping. The angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him on the day. So important that we see things for what it is, and we really do need God to focus our hearts and minds on Him. So let's just kind of do that this morning together. Lord God, today, this time of the year tends to be really, really busy with stuff. And even on Sunday mornings, this first day of the week, when we get up and we're getting ready and getting the kids ready and Christmas parties for our kids, while we want those to focus and get them to see you, and Lord, things like the joys of giving, so often the things that we do can actually detract from the purpose. Lord, this morning I just pray that we would just take a breath. Lord, that we would realize what is important this morning. Lord, that we would see this time of year, this time of the week, this time of this day for what it is. Lord, help us to center our hearts, focus our hearts and minds on you. Lord, I pray that your word would be alive in us today. Lord, that this would not be just something that we check off of our list, but rather, Lord God, that you would be alive and real, and that we would understand the reality of a relationship with you, the reality of what you're trying to do in our lives today, the importance of what's going on. And so, Lord, we just thank you. I just pray that Lord, you would just give us your peace and mercy today. Lord, help us to, again, focus on you, we pray in your precious name. Amen. This morning, Luke chapter number 1, verse number 3 and 4, Luke writes to Theophilus, and he says, Theophilus, I'm writing the book of Luke so that you will have a thorough understanding, a complete understanding of what God has done from the beginning to now, the work that God is trying to do in this life, that God is trying to get something done, that there is a plan, that he has a plan when Jesus Christ came. That's why the most complete Christmas story, the Christmas story we ordinarily read, if you read a Christmas story on Christmas Day, which is always awesome, especially when your kids are young. This is the Christmas story that when I was in Christian school that we were encouraged. I'll go ahead and say forced to memorize. Was this story. Was this account of the Christmas story. Of how this thorough account of what God is doing in this world. And I would just encourage you this morning that God is still at work in his world. God has a plan for his world. God has a plan in your world. Man, as we're trying to get things done and we want what we want for our lives, I just want to encourage you this morning that God has a plan for your life. And it's more than you trying to make the bills. And it's more than you trying to make things work in your family and in your time and according to your plan. God has a specific plan. And his plan in this world, we've said the last couple weeks, that his plan in his world includes, first of all, ordinary people. Just regular, ordinary people. And he does it with you. So you don't have to be this superstar that you thought was this incredible person that, you know, people are always like, well, Tony, I can't pray in public, or I can't teach a class, I can't, you may have in your mind this idea that these good Christian people are different than you. And they're just not. That person that you think is the knees of his pants are wore out because he prays all the time and he doesn't have any kind of bad thoughts and he treats everybody nice all the time just because he's a great person. And that's a term we use, isn't it? He's just a good person. That guy doesn't exist. Right? The guy that, you'd be amazed at how many times even during my week as a pastor even, that I have to stop and intentionally think before I say something really dumb. For this is my natural tendency. It's one of my negative defaults that can get me in real trouble is my smart mouth. And so I was talking to the Coppages about, they just had an anniversary. And I said, how many years have you been married? They told me, I said, how many of the happiest years of your life? Right? Because those are often not the same dates, not the same time frames. And in my life, it was like that, right? The number of years I've been married, not the same number of years, the happiest years of my life, because the first several years of my life were also, the first couple were also the most smart-aleck years of my life. My wife one time said, you always think you're right. I said, if I thought I was wrong, I'd change my mind. There were 3 days of silence in my house. I'm not talking to you. I'm like, you promise? That ain't good. That's how you end up making
supper. Right? You end up with sandwiches when you come home from work. Right? It's like the guy, the man and woman who were arguing. Neither one of them wanted to be the first one to break the silence. And so he had to catch a flight early the next morning. So he wrote a note and put it on a pillow. Said, I need to catch a flight. Wake me up at 3:30. He woke up at 4:30, had a note on his pillow. Wake up, it's 4:30. Right? So that whole, wow, our negative defaults, we think that there's just these good people that just do good all the time because they're just naturally good people. They're just like that. And that person doesn't exist. We have to conform to God's plan. Just common people do God's work. Secondly, they have unique tasks. God gives us all unique tasks to do for Him. You have one. You may be not doing it well, but you do have a task that God intends for you to fulfill in your life. And then we're talking about this morning how that we all have these incredible gifts that God has given us. God has gifted you in a very special way to do something that only you can do. It's your part in God's plan. And so, can God use somebody else? God can use somebody else, but really you're the one that's missing out when you don't take a part in what God has designed you to do in His awesome plan. So, this morning we're going to continue looking at those who we were looking at for this series on how God does what God does in His world. So God has gifted everybody, first of all, just by way of introduction, with the same basic things. God has gifted you with spiritual gifts. Everybody in here has a unique spiritual gift, maybe more than one, that only you, it's your spiritual gift that God can use for Him in His service. Also, God has gifted you with a certain heart for certain things. For example, in your life, and we talk about this in the new members class, where there's something that you look at in this life where you say, I bet it hurts the heart of God that blank. Maybe it's teenagers. Maybe you have a heart for teenagers. Maybe you have a heart for children. Maybe you have a heart for the elderly. Maybe you have a heart for young adults. Maybe you have a heart for whatever, the indigent or people who are struggling with disabilities. You have a certain heart that God has given you for certain areas. Also, each one of us have certain abilities that God has given us. God has given certain people abilities, and you have certain abilities that are good. Have you ever noticed how when you first come to know somebody, they have certain attributes that you think are really, really awesome, and then as you get to know them longer, you get to thinking that they're negative attributes? Right? For example, when you first get to know them and they are good with money, they're thrifty, they're good at money, they're a good budgeter. Then if you marry them, then they're tight, they're a skimpflint then. Right? Maybe when you married him, he was funny. Now he's corny. Right? Now he's immature. I don't know why we're on family this morning. But just whatever it is, you get to know somebody, maybe whatever it is, maybe they were grave and sober and now they're dry and they don't have a sense of humor. But whatever it is, whatever your personality is, God has given you that as personalities. Given everybody a certain personality that He can use for Him. Personalities, abilities, experiences. We were talking about in Sunday school this morning, the different experiences that brought us to the Lord. Now, I don't know what you've experienced in this life, but God can use those experiences for Him. All those things are gifts from God. Even difficult things, the Bible says that God goes with us through our difficult times so we can go with other people through their difficult times. So what God does, He gives us these incredible gifts. We're going to look at some examples here in the lives of Zechariah and Elizabeth. Mary and Joseph, the shepherds, and the wise men. We'll look at these quickly this morning. First of all, Zechariah and Elizabeth. And remember, all these common people, these are just common people. There are some people who disagree that they're all common people, but I'm telling you, God just picks out these people who were common people, who weren't known, they weren't extra special people, even though Zechariah was someone who was a priest, but he was picked out. Notice that
they were picked out, first of all, that what God did, and the gift that God gave Zechariah and Elizabeth primarily was the miraculous. He did some miraculous things in their life. He did a miraculous miracle in their life. One of the areas where he gifted them was this area of really showing up in an amazing way. Look at what the Bible says in Luke chapter number 1, verse number 7. First of all, he showed up in a miraculous way in the positive. In verse number 7 and verse number 13, you'll see where the Bible says, and they had no child because Elizabeth was barren and they both were well stricken in years. You see this over and over in Scripture. You see it in Abraham and Sarah. You see it in Isaac and Rebekah. You see it in different people's lives where God miraculously comes through in this area of children. But here you see this positive, miraculous event that God does. Maybe God has done that with you, or God has put you in a position through something miraculous. Which is like, man, I just can't explain it, but God has done some awesome things in my life. The Bible says in verse number 13, the angel said unto him, fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard. And thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. So you see this positive, miraculous thing. But not just the positive thing. You see also that God did the miraculous in his life, even in the negative. Because Zacharias ends up saying, well, how will I know? And I love this story. I love this part of Zacharias and Elizabeth's story. Because Zacharias, the priest, someone who should have the faith, Gabriel shows up and he says, I'm Gabriel, the angel of God. And we're going to do this miraculous thing. And so Zechariah says in verse number 18 through verse number 20, well, how will I know? So get the picture, right? Play the picture game in your mind. Zechariah is doing the priest's office. It's just him in the temple. So he's offering the sacrifice in the priest's office. He's doing his thing. And the angel of God shows up. Zechariah's like, hey. And he says, look, your wife, even though she's past bearing and hasn't been able to have a child this whole time, is going to have a child. You're going to call his name John. By the way, I'm Gabriel, the angel of God. And if you read verse number 18 through verse number 20, Zechariah says, well, how will I know? And he repeats, I'm Gabriel, the angel of God. How will you know? Well, you need another sign. An angel just showed up. Okay, I'll give you another sign. It's going to be miraculous. You're not going to be able to talk till it happens. Your wife is going to be blessed with 9 months of silence. You're going to be cursed with 9 months of silence. You're not going to be able to talk until it happens. Listen, there are some things in your life that can even be negative blessings where God can use something negative in your life for you to show the miraculous power of God. Where God, listen, my dad, a lot of you know, I've been praying for my dad, and I appreciate that. He was here at my granddaughter's birthday party yesterday, but my dad was hit head-on on 31 by a guy who crossed over the median and hit him head-on. Shattered his hip and all this stuff. My dad had one of two choices. He can use that for the glory of God. He can get better and show God's glory through it and continue. He can go and preach in a wheelchair, or, which now he's standing up, or he can get bitter. Well, listen, that accident, what we may call an accident, can be used for God's glory. Listen, I don't know what you're going through in your life, but God can use that event through God's glory. God can do a miraculous thing, positive or negative, in your life and do something beautiful with it. But what was it going to take? The second thing is, it was a call to buck cultural norms. This also is a gift from God. A call for Zechariah and Elizabeth to buck cultural norms. Now, what does he say? Verse number 59 through verse number 63. He says, you're going to call his name John in verse number 13. Or excuse me, verse number 13. The angel said to him, fear not, your prayer has been heard. You're going to have a child. You're going to call his name John. And then in verse number 59 through verse number 63, the Bible says that it came to pass on the eighth day when it came to circumcise the child that they called him Zacharias. Everybody came together. It was a big event at that time and in that culture. And they called his name Zacharias after his father, since his father couldn't talk. They said, hey, this is awesome. You have a child, you have a son, and this is a big deal. We're going to call him Zacharias. And his mom said, no, we're going to call him John. And they said, you're not going to call him John because nobody in this family is named John. There's nobody in your family tree named John. They always named him after their father or after some spiritual significance. We're going to call him Zacharias. And they said, no, we're going to call him John, the mother said. So they said, well, we need to ask Zacharias about it then. So that's what they did. So they gave Zacharias something to write on. Zacharias says in verse number 63, notice how firm Zacharias is in his statement. Zacharias says in verse number 63, and they asked for a writing table, and he wrote saying, his name is John. And what happened? They all marveled. It is a gift from God, this call to be different. This call for you and I to buck cultural norms, for us to be unique for Christ's sake, for us to be different, for us to have the opportunity for somebody to look at your Christmas, to look at your family, to look at your life and say, because of what God has done in their life, they are different. Something is very different about what God has done and what God is doing in their life. It's very attractive. How do people see Christ today? He's not going to be born again in a manger. That's happened and it was awesome. But now the gift that God has given you and I is the call to be unique enough to where God sees, or people see rather, that God has done the miraculous in our life. And through that, they see that it is distinct and different. The Bible says they marveled. They couldn't believe it. Why in the world would you call your child John? Why? Because God is doing something in my family. Because it's different. Number two, look at Mary and Joseph. Look at how they were gifted. The Bible says in verse number 26 of chapter number 1, and in 6 months the angel Gabriel was sent from God in the city of Galilee, named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, in the house of David. This is verse number 26 of Luke chapter number 1. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came into her and said, hail, thou art highly favored, and the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Why? Because of this special task. We talked about the unique task that all these people had. Now we're talking about the gift. And when she saw him, won't you look at what the Bible says? She was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this must be. One of the gifts that Mary and Joseph had was that these were thoughtful people. They had the right heart. And they were very thoughtful about what God was going to do. These were very... These people, they first of all already had the right hearts, but they also were very thoughtful. When they were told by God, Mary didn't say, well, what about this and what about that? Imagine if God was going to tell you that before you had a child, you were engaged to be married, and before you end up getting married, you're going to get pregnant, you're going to have a child, and this child was going to be the Christ. What would you do? I don't know what y'all do. I would say, okay, can we sit down and talk, have some questions? It's not what Mary did. You know what Mary did? She keeps these things, the Bible says, quiet, and she ponders them in her heart. Angel Gabriel says, this is what it's going to be? And Mary says, okay. She ponders them in her heart. Fact matter is, look at what Joseph does. The Bible says, and these people are not picked at random. This is the point. The point is, God has a plan for your life, and He's not picking you at random. God has something unique for you to do in His kingdom from the beginning to the end. And He's not calling you just because He can't find somebody else to do it. It's not like, look, we really need somebody to teach the fourth and fifth grade class, and if nobody else will do it, I'll do it. We're talking about God has picked you, designed you, gifted you, giving you the right experiences to do something specific for Him. It ought to be your life's purpose to find where it is that you fit in God's plan. Joseph does the same thing. Look what happens. The Bible says in Matthew chapter number 1, verse number 18, now the birth of Christ was like this. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, they were found with child of the Holy Ghost, and Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not willing to make an example of her publicly, was minded to put her away privately. And while he thought on these things, this is before he ever saw an angel, before he was ever contacted by God, he was not somebody to do things rashly. It was how he was already gifted. While he thought on these things, then the angel shows up. And what is the gift of the call? What is it that they were called to do? How is it they were to respond to this thoughtfulness? How was it? They were called to be submissive. Because I'm going to tell you something. If God's going to live at your house, I was talking to Justin. I said, we've got three different people live at our house at three different times just to kind of try to help people out. If you want to do better as a Christian, let somebody live with you. It'll end the conversation. It'll end the argument you was going to have. You don't know how to act like a Christian? Move somebody in into your house. You have to act like a Christian even if you didn't want to. Like, I really wanted to have an argument right now, but they're eating eggs and bacon with us. They just saved your life. Right? Move God in your house. There are two things you're going to want if God lives with you. You're going to want to be thoughtful, and you're going to want to be submissive. We're talking about the parents of Jesus Christ. They were gifted to do that. They were common people who had a common task, who had a specific task, and they had specific gifts, incredible gifts, that gifted them to do what God had called them to do. If you today believe that God is real and that God is at work in His world, then you have to want to be involved, and you have to begin to look at how God gifted you to do that which you can do in His kingdom. Look at the shepherds. The shepherds here are in the field. We talked about what they were called to do. We talked about their unique calling. We talked about how they were just common people. But look at here how they're gifted. First of all, this awesome experience. These guys had this experience. Remember how they were called to go and tell all the people. How they were called to go and spread the word all through the countryside that the Messiah was come. These are just, and why were they called to do it? Because they knew the people. They were put in the exact right spot to do it. But look at how they were gifted. They were gifted with this awesome experience that made it simple for them to just tell. Listen, if you were going to have people be your communicators for a message, would you call shepherds? I'm going to probably say no. Guys who hang out in the field all the time? Probably not going to be your most dynamic speakers. How are they going to be your most dynamic speakers? They're going to be your most dynamic speakers if you give them with an experience that they want to tell. This is why in Luke chapter number 2, the Bible says, and the angel of the Lord came to them, the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And then there was this, all of a sudden the heavenly host began to sing, and they told them exactly what was going on. And you see this experience in their life where there was this great light that shone, and they were like, listen, if this was the experience that happened to you, I'm going to guess that the first thing you would do is go home and tell somebody. You are not going to believe what happened to me out there with them sheep in that field. And it wouldn't be hard for you to do it. You wouldn't have to take an evangelism class. Listen, this is why when a guy goes out into the woods by himself, he kills a deer of significance. It's not hard for him to tell the story. It was a significant experience in his life. So much so that he'll ride around town with it till the thing gets rigor mortis. Right? He'll take pictures on his phone. He'll show people, he'll tell people, it's easy, like the experience. It was a unique experience. It was an awesome experience in his life. And this is the same thing that happens to you. Listen, this is why people who God saves miraculously, have this awesome opportunity. Brother Scott was saying one time, he said, you know, it's almost upsetting that I don't have this testimony that God saved me from this, you know, that I was deep in sin, and I was doing all these horrible things, and then God saves me out of this. Man, because he said, what an awesome opportunity it would be to have that kind of testimony where I could tell people, look where I was and look where I am. And I told Brother Scott, I said, listen, God has saved you and I from the same thing. Just saved us on the front end, that's all. And so we're all saved from the same thing. But listen, some of you have these miraculous experiences, some things, awesome things that God has done in your life. For example, for my dad, who went from being just an abusive alcoholic to a pastor, surrendered to preach 2 weeks later, that's kind of a testimony that everybody don't get to have. Some of you have experiences in your life where God has just showed up in an amazing way. And here you see the gift of an awesome testimony that people just love to hear. And how did they use it? What was the call? The call to just share the message. I love what this verse says in verse number 10 and verse through verse number 14. The Bible says, and the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you, this is a message for you, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to, next words, all people. I bring you good tidings of great joy, and this good tidings of great joy is going to be to all people. How's it going to get to all people? You're going to go tell them. You're not going to not be able to tell them. After we show up in such a mighty way in your life, man, listen, you're going to be able to tell them. This is why you and I have to focus on our relationship with the Lord, focus on what God's doing in our life. Just here recently, we had this little family thing. We invited somebody to come with us, and they were like, look, it's just so impressive that y'all can have a family thing and not have all this bickering and arguing and knockdown dragouts. I wish I had that in my family. And it gave me an opportunity to talk to them about just real quick, just simple, how that God is the why to how you do the what. How that God can make a difference in everybody's life. Does it mean you're not going to have any kind of issues? It doesn't. It just means the issues don't have to have you. And we can see God come into our lives and make a difference in our lives. And other people can look at it and say, man, that's an experience that I would like to have. And you can show God mightily in your life. Lastly, number four, we'll look at the experience of the wise men. We'll look at the gift of the wise men. And again, all of us have these spiritual gifts. We have many gifts that God gives us to do what He's called us to do. Spiritual gifts, the right heart, the right abilities, the right personalities, the right experiences. We're just barely touching on how God has gifted us to do that which He's called us to do. So many of us are scared to death that we can't be a part of what God's doing because we're not gifted enough to do it. It's just not true. Because in our minds, we think we have to be a superstar to do it, and it's just not true. One of my favorite passages of Scripture is recorded twice, one in 2 Chronicles, one in 2 Samuel, and it's a record of David's mighty men of valor. David had a group of people that traveled to him when he was running from Saul in the wilderness, and they were just kind of attracted to him. David was just kind of natural leader. And it records that they were mighty men of valor, and it also records why. So it goes through this list, and it says, this person was mighty because he fought this Egyptian who was a mighty warrior, and he fought him when he came to him. He didn't have a weapon. And so he runs to the Egyptian, and he takes his weapon from him. And he kills the Egyptian warrior and his friends. And he was a mighty man of valor. This is also where one of my favorite stories of the man in the lentil field. Remember the story of the man in the lentil field, and David's men were planting beans out in the mountains, and the Philistines come out there, and somebody says, hey, the Philistines are here, and everybody runs except for this one mighty man of valor from David. And this guy thinks to himself, you know what? I serve my master David. My master David serves the Lord, and I'm not running. So by himself, he stands in the lentil field, and he says, you're not getting one bean while my master David and my God lives. And so he fights all these Egyptians. The Bible says, all these Philistines, he kills them until his hand won't open up off the sword. And he was a mighty man of valor. You know who the last mighty man of valor is?
an armor bearer. You know what armor bearers do? They bear armor. That's it. As far as I know, unless there's something I don't know about bearing armor, they tote armor around. You know what this guy was mighty to do? He was mighty to be there and do what needed to be done. Because imagine if you're a mighty man of valor and you call for your sword and there's no sword there. It makes you considerably less mighty. That's a guy you need to be mighty too. The guy who's the support guy. Now, how you know you have a good sound person, a good person doing your sound? Because you don't know they're there. When they're not doing a good job, then you know they're there. Right? You have good audio people, you don't know you have good audio people. They just do a good job week after week after week. You know how you have good Sunday, you know how you know you have good Sunday school teachers and good workers is because you don't know you have good Sunday school teachers and good workers. It's only when they're bad that you know. Guys, listen, it's not that we need to all be these great and mighty people, we just need to be these consistent people that God's called and gifted to do this great thing that God can use. I heard a story. Look at these wise men. Notice that their gift was their background, their training, their position. Here, these men from the east could have been easily up to 800 miles away. They come on these camels and on these horses and hear from easily up to 800 miles away. They have this background and position that helps them do that which God has called them to do. The Bible says now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, in Matthew chapter number 2, verse number 1, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east. What do these guys do? These magi. They spend their time studying the art, studying the truths about life. These are intellectuals. They are people of higher learning. They're people who spend their time. They're good at it. They're studying. They're looking for truth. They have been looking, probably as lost Gentile people, have been looking for the truth of the coming Messiah, which could have helped them, by the way, in hopefully the fall of the Roman Empire. But they're looking for this coming Messiah. They were in the position where they could see Him coming. So when they see the star from the east, they know what it means immediately. They can identify it. They can help others identify it. Why? Because they had that gift of being in the right position, being in the right place to see it. Maybe some of you are just good at studying, good at telling other people, good at explaining things to people. Maybe you're gifted teachers and just not using it for the cause of Christ. Not using it for where God has designed you to use it. And what was their call? Their call was simply to follow. To follow that direction of God in their life. The Bible says this, and when they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over the young child where it was. You got to wonder, don't you? What you're using your gifts for and what you're following. How are you applying your gifts in your life, and where is it going to take you? God had gifted these guys to the position where they were, and they find themselves kneeling before the Maker of heaven and earth. Why? Because they were willing to follow. All of these gifts come with a call to submit and follow the call of God in your life. They come to realize that God is who He said He was and is working and has a purpose for your life specifically. Not for you to come to church and be a part of what God is doing in that collective, but understanding that you as a common person have a unique task and have been gifted specifically to do what God has called you to do in the part of what He's doing in this world. And that He's more than willing to do it. One of the things that we're looking at next year
is helping each individual member of UofL Baptist Church find where God has gifted them specifically and how to apply that here or elsewhere. Every person. Why? Because it's so important that before you end your life, that you find how God has designed you to be used in His kingdom. As musicians come, look, this is the, what do they call it? The season of giving. You ever given somebody something and realize right away that they didn't like it and were not going to use it? They're not using that. Or maybe you went to the garage sale and you found your gift that you spent time thinking about and buying, and it's like that thing hadn't been opened. Or God forgive that they re-gifted it. You gave it and they were like, oh, that's awesome. I'll make a great gift for somebody else. I won't have to go buy that. Spend all that time trying to find the perfect gift. That's why Rachel and I don't Christmas shop together. She's a great gift buyer, gift giver. Because she thinks it might be that perfect gift that exists for somebody. I don't think that gift exists. I don't think you know. I know better than you know, probably. She's good at it and she enjoys it. But this is that time here where we go out of our way to give things to other people. Listen, that's what God did in this life for you. What a horrible thing it would be to get to the end of my life. For one day, for my casket to be here, and everybody get the word that Tony's funeral is going to be held on blank day, and that on the day that I stand before God, the gift that He gave me, the gifts that He gave me were still in the box. And I was like, God, but you know, I was really busy. And I had a lot to do, and life just kind of took on its own life, and I was going to get to it. I heard a poem one time that said, it was going to be all that a man could be tomorrow. The world would have known him if only he'd seen tomorrow. The fact is he died, faded from view. And all that was left when his living was through, the big stack of things he intended to do tomorrow. Guys, listen. Let's not allow our lives and our gifts to be wasted. The Bible says that we are created in His likeness. We are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God has ordained that we should walk in Him. So we stand together. The only question, the question is not today if you've been gifted. You've been gifted. The question is today whether or not you and I submit to use the gifts that God has given us for the purpose for which He's given us. Heads bowed and eyes closed as we pray together. Would you make a commitment to God today to say, Lord, I don't even know what my gifts are. I don't know how you can use me. But Lord, if you'll show me what you want me to do, that's all I'm asking. Lord, if you'll show me what you want me to do, then I will commit today to do it. Will you just do that? Say, Lord, I don't know what it is, but if you'll show me, I'll do it. Maybe scary. Maybe even out of my comfort zone. But if you show me, I'll do it. As musicians play.
So